were young and pretty.
Well, Don, what a privilege to see you here in New York City, the home of country music, as you so accurately
The home of country music, yeah.
But with this fantastic new album, Cass County, I love it.
Thank you. I really love it. Thank you.
Now, of course, that's home for you. That's where you're from.
It is, indeed. It's, I spent the first 23, 24 years of my life there. And I spent what people refer to as their formative years in that place. Very small place. Very rural. It's not near. People say, well, what city is it near? And I said, it's not near any city. it's in the middle of nowhere.
The years went rushing by in the twinkling of an eye. We rolled with the changes. The light we knew was gone. Our friends had all moved on. Time rearranging.
Have you wanted to capture it or capture the essence of it in an album for a while? Has it been on your mind? Has it been something you wanted to do?
I think I've been thinking about it a long time. As you get older, you know, you start to look back and things, you get perspective on your life. And I've never really abandoned the place. I'm still very involved in civic affairs there. I mean, we're trying to rebuild the town. Like a lot of small towns across America, it's dying. You know, it's just fading away because there's no industry, there's no economic engine there anymore. There are no jobs. And there are some of us around my age who have got second homes there. I mean, I kept my mother's home. She passed away in 2003, and I kept the home. And I take my children there, my wife and children, and I go there just to show them what small town life is like. And I still have very dear friends there that I went to high school with. Some of them were instrumental in my music career, in introducing me to music and the playing of music.
I give it everything I had. To the good times and the bad. But now I'm down here on the floor. Cause I don't know you anymore.
This album isn't so much about my town or the people in it. It's more just about the general atmosphere. It's more about interior landscapes than it is about exterior landscapes. I mean, there are a few songs that are more autobiographical than others. Train in the Distance is very autobiographical. Waiting Tables, you know, about a waitress I knew there. And a couple of other things. But mostly the album captures the textures and the musical sounds that I heard as a child growing up there. And it also deals with the theme of home. What is home? Where is home? What does home mean to people? What is the importance of place?
Take a picture of you. Take a picture of you.
And your mum took you to buy your first drum kit because you managed to pinch a few bits from the school hall, I think, and cobble together some, but you needed a proper one.
Yeah. Well,
you obviously must have shown some talent.
She saw that I had talent.
Yeah.
And she was a musician. She played piano, not professionally, of course, but mostly gospel music and a few other things. And I had piano lessons when I was a kid, but I didn't stick with it. Just wanted to go outside and play. You know? And then one day my mother said, come get in the car. I think I was about 15 years old, couldn't drive yet. And she drove 80 miles to the nearest music store of any size where they actually had a drum set. I think she had called them on the phone first. And she ended up, much to my amazement, buying me this set of red sparkle, beautiful drums, put them in the boot of the car and went back to our, on the way to our hometown, she stopped at my father's shop and opened the boot and she said, here's what I've done. And he went, okay. And then things went on from there. But she and my father were both music lovers. And my maternal grandmother lived with us You know, that's what you do in the South when your parents get old. She would sit in her rocking chair all day singing hymns and songs by an American composer named Stephen Foster, who wrote the quintessential sappy American ballads. You know, My Old Kentucky Home and Way Down Upon the Suwannee River and all that. And my grandmother would sing those songs, which is probably was a big influence on Desperado.
And it was a country, you know, performer, Kenny Rogers, who got you started.
Yeah.
You bumped into him in a shop.
Quite by chance.
And he was perhaps looking to make connection with one of the girls in the shop, I think, at
yes,
the time.
Yes, she was a beautiful girl. Kenny was in there, you know, I'm not sure he was interested in the clothing, but it was a modern, it was a hip clothing boutique, you know, it was sort of like the shops that you had on Kings Road and Carnaby Street and all that. They sold bell-bottom pants and Nehru jackets and all those things, and it was the summer of 68. And Kenny Rogers and his group, The First Edition, were just becoming very famous at that time. They had a song called Just Dropped In to See What Condition My Condition Was In.
Yes.
Tripped on a clouded bell 8 miles high, tore my mind while checking the sky. Dropped in to see what condition my condition was in.
And so they were on tour, and they were in Dallas to do a concert, and we were there to play in some little club. And one of the bolder members of my band just walked right up to him and said, "Hi, my name's Jerry, and this is my band, and we're playing at a local club. Would you be interested in coming and hearing us play?" And he said, "Yeah," because Kenny's a Texas boy, you know, and I think he had some sympathy, some empathy at least for us. And so he showed up, and he said, "I think you're good." He said, "I'm thinking about producing some artists, and I might be interested in producing an album for you, but I can't do it right now because I'm on tour and my group is very successful. So it might take a year or two." And it did. But we kept in touch with him until late 1969. We got a call from him. He said, "Okay, it's time to come to California now." And so we packed up all of our stuff, and I had a car. And my friend Richard had a car, and we had a little trailer that we pulled behind the car. And we drove from our town of 2,400 people to Los Angeles, California. And, you know, we weren't developed as songwriters at that point in our career. We weren't good songwriters at all. And there weren't that many great singers in the band, frankly. And so, you know, not much happened, but we learned a lot. You know, the main thing is it got us to Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And we managed to stay there somehow and survive.
And meet the right people.
When
I stop dreaming, that's when I stop loving you.
On this album, you have some guest singers, and most of them are women.
Yeah.
And you've mostly sung with blokes most of
exactly.
your life.
Exactly.
So is that a nice change?
It was a lovely change. You know, I, as you point out, I mostly sung with menfolk for most of my career. And a lot of those women are people that I greatly admire, and I love their voices. Some of them I knew personally. Trisha Yearwood is a dear friend of mine. I had met Dolly once or twice before.
What was it like recording with Dolly?
It was marvelous. She is such a professional and such a kind, humble human being. Her voice is so unique, and it represents such an important part of American culture. The sound of that voice represents the people who live in the mountainous regions of the eastern portion of the United States. You know, the Great Smoky Mountains, the Appalachians, the Blue Ridge Mountains. You know, that voice is a mountain voice. And you hear the culture of those people. You hear the suffering and the hardship, and you also hear the love and the compassion in that voice. You know, it's all in there. And she's such a petite little person, but boy, when she opens her mouth to sing.
When I stop
that's when I'll stop loving you.
You caught up with Billy Joel, who did a fantastic Q&A to launch your album earlier.
Yeah, I love Billy. Billy and I are trying to find the time to sit down and maybe write a song or two together.
That'd be amazing.
Which would be great. Because he needs to start writing again. He just stopped writing, you know. He just
years
got tired.
Ago. He hasn't written anything for so long.
For long, yeah. Well, he says that pop music bores him, and I understand that sentiment. A lot of it bores me too, to tears. But that just means that we need to write some better stuff and put it out there.
And where does this tour and this solo project leave your future with the Eagles? What's happening with the band?
Well, we are definitely taking the remainder of this year off because we've been going at it great guns, you know. We've been going at it hard for quite some time, especially during the last couple of years in that documentary we made.
Brilliant.
Just set the career on fire again, you know, and ticket sales went through the roof and people wanted to come and see the show again. And it was a complete rebirth of our, we weren't doing badly before, mind you, but the documentary just kicked it into another gear completely.
Gotta take it to the limit one more time.
So we've all agreed that nothing else for the remainder of this year. Then we've got our Kennedy Center Honors coming up in December.
Congratulations.
Thank
on
you.
That. How exciting.
We're delighted.
Do you get to perform at that or someone else performs
one
of your
that's
songs?
That's the beautiful thing about it. I went and did it. I performed a Billy Joel song when he was honored a couple of years ago. And that was really nerve-wracking.
She's got a way of talking.
Been
all right.
So lovely.
Always
to
a
see
pleasure
you.
To talk to you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
Thank you.